Adam Bradley, Andrew DuBois, nice to talk to you.
Great to talk to you.
So you guys were studying poetry and literary criticism by day and what, at night listening to rap?
At night, at day, any between classes, whenever possible, we were listening to all the great rap artists of that period of the mid to late 90s. So you're thinking about the Wu-Tang Clan, Biggie and Tupac, Outkast. And I soon found out that I had a partner in rhyme who was also listening to the same things, even as we were taking courses in poetics and, you know, the whole literary canon. And there was a kind of synergy that we both saw going on between those things, and a synergy between us in our discussions of those connections between hip-hop and the literary canon more broadly.
Was there an aha moment when you thought to yourself, why isn't this stuff being studied and taught in the academy?
Unbeknownst to a lot of people, I think, been being taught for a long time. Mm-hmm. But as we were becoming teachers, you know, graduate teaching assistants, we realized that one of the ways that an art form gets disseminated and understood and appreciated is by having materials that make it available to people, as opposed to a certain logistical difficulty of having to dig things up, having certain problems with the kinds of songs that you're using. And so to have something in one place that a teacher could go to, we knew would be helpful in the classroom.
Rap as lyric poetry. Make the case for me.
Well, you have rhythm, you have rhyme, you have wordplay, you have these basic elements expressed in a new form. So the lyre is transformed now into a kick drum and a snare, or a beatbox, or a hand tapping on a lunchroom table to provide that beat in which the rapper, the MC, the master of ceremonies can inhabit that space and create his or her lyrics. You know, this is really what we were seeing, a connection across time and across rhymes. I mean, sometimes it's explicit. Sometimes it has to do with strong stress meter that we see in Beowulf, finding new life in the four-beat line of a rap lyric. Sometimes it's more subtle in the ways that a poet uses bend syllables, creates these small moments of alliteration or of multisyllabic rhyme or whatever it may be. These are the full contents of the poet's toolbox put on display, set to music, and disseminated around the globe.
Because they have the same qualities as the poetry you're studying by day?
Poetry is based on words spoken in a relationship to music. Lyric poetry, etymologically speaking, comes from the lyre, words spoken to the playing of the lyre. So song lyrics also are directly connected to lyric poetry. They're of the same family tree. There's a continuum of poetry, something from pure sound poetry to oral poetry to written poetry that is then sung to the playing of an instrument, such as, for instance, the Psalms, all the way up to something like strictly page-based poetry. But this is what poetry is. There's a continuum of poetry, and rap lyrics rest on that continuum.
Ice Cube, Jay-Z, Queen Latifah, is this the Shelley, Frost, Emily Dickinson of our day? You want to take it that far?
We discovered early on in our discussions about rap that we wanted to unfetter the hip-hop tradition from all other traditions. Often when you have discussions, for instance, in a high school classroom and a well-intentioned teacher wants to bring in rap, they'll do something like rap and Shakespeare, you know, some sort of cosigner to say it's okay to talk about rap. What we wanted to do with the anthology is to say that this is a tradition in full. Yes, it's related in profound ways to the broader tradition of Western lyric poetry. Yes, it's related in profound ways to the American songbook across all genres of music. And yes, it's related in important ways as well to the African American oral tradition of the toasts, signifying, the dozens. It's all there, but finally, it's a tradition that can stand on its own, that has its own connections across its almost 40-year history, and we wanted this tradition to be displayed without any sort of co-signing, without any sort of thing to say that it needs to be treated seriously. It's already serious, and not serious. It's playful, but it's also quite profound. You have all of that within this book.
What about the rap on rap? Of course, the violence, the misogyny, the profanity. And a lot of people would say, how could you think about that in terms of lyric poetry?
The important thing is that when it is there, it makes no sense not to take it seriously and look at it without having a knee-jerk reaction or an over-determined response. Now I would like to return to making connections to things that are considered canonical literature. We could think of so many poets and dramatists and novelists whose materials by someone, anyone, might be considered utterly offensive. We don't stop teaching those things, we don't stop reading those things, and we don't stop publishing those things. We don't stop publishing Howell or Ulysses or Shakespeare, things that have been considered by different people at different times to be terribly offensive.
It's great for language in poetry to be controversial again. I think it is. I think for as many people as care about rap, to me it's a wonderful thing for anyone who writes, regardless of your particular way of doing it. The attention that rap has garnered for language, explicit or otherwise, is something that has an impact, has an influence. There are grandmothers in suburban, Wisconsin who are saying bling bling and don't know that it came from BG and Lil Wayne. There are people all over the world who have keyed in to the frequencies of hip hop language and to the music that these artists have created. And for us, that's what we wanted to celebrate in the Anthology of Rap.
Adam Bradley and Andrew DuBois, nice to talk to you.
You too.
Thank you.